Yeah. I I kind of got press corps already coming and put their notepads down, but you can grab one of these remaining things, and if you want some Wi-Fi, there's a Wi-Fi password on the screen back here around the corner. And after the briefing, just sit tight, somebody will come down here and we'll escort you out. Okay?
And before we start the briefing, I can give some feed from there, from the network.
Yeah, you can, but beware, people are gonna be coming and going.
need it, don't worry about it.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I
easier than that works if we do have a photographer for this, if we can just use them to do this. There are cameras set up here in the group room, and there's some help feeding that. If you want, I can go ask Pat if we can get a camera and then see how they're feeding their eating bag, but you might have to ask one of the cameramen here. Taft did, he's one of the public affairs officers here, and he said, hey, I saw your videographer here, and I was like, what are you talking about? So. Oh, okay. Well, you want me? Cool, and also another thing with the Slack, can you help me upload the video to this dash? It hasn't been checked yet, so I can at least get the story up and air this morning. What do you mean? I see digital production, but not video production. Oh, okay, yep. Okay, cool. Thank you so much. I'll get that done right now. Cool. All right, thanks. All right, bye. I see digital production, but not video production. Oh, okay, yep. Okay, cool. Thank you so much. I'll get that done right now. Cool. All right, thanks.
Sorry?
Mm-hmm.
CBS.
CBS.
It's cool.
Oh, right.
Yeah. It's ABC, but he's cool also. So he'll be shooting all of the people asking questions, and I just do the head on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's the answer is.
Therese.
Yeah, do you know my name is CBS?
Oh, good. Who are you with now?
I'm with the UG.
Oh, I can help make that happen.
Oh,
Yeah, let me know.
Yeah, he was my mentor, so he's a great guy.
Yeah, he is.
I was trying to see if possibly one of these cameras, they may want me to go live, and I was gonna see if there was any chance after leaving, one of them, they'll make me roll out, you know.
And sorry, who are you with again?
Newsy.
Newsy?
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
Yeah, I don't know how that works.
That would probably be tough, because these are network cameras that are provided by the pool. And even if you were in the pool, it'd probably be hard to, because, you know, the networks are, the head-on does head-on and the cuts does cuts.
What about after?
Well, that would be something that, and what I suspect is that your news organization would have to reach out to ABC, and then ABC would have to reach out to the pool. So, I mean, it would be a lot in detail, and I don't think the odds are very good about doing a stand-up from your camera.
Hi.
I'm curious, I'm with ABC. Yeah, we don't have a videographer, so they were trying to see if there's any way possible.
What is your videographer?
I think they're traveling, so we just don't have any. So they were trying to see if I could possibly see if one of the cameras after the briefing would be willing to be a role on all of these, so if they'd be willing to shoot it. But I was gonna go talk to staff and see how that works, because I've never had to know anything like that.
Maybe they can do a three-hour show, kind of real show.
Yeah, that would be.
Yeah, but then they'd have to be clearer than anything else, I don't know.
Right, but I'm just saying, realistically, your odds of that happening are not good.
Yeah.
Because they're really stringent as far as what they do, and they just wouldn't want to set any type of precedent, I think, for doing something ad hoc like that. I mean, it's so, like, yesterday there were three or four cut cameras,
mm-hmm.
and they were, yeah, you were here, they were on network. And even that would be tough, because the camera guys would have to run it up. If it was just a unilateral thing and you could work it with your company and one network, that would be one thing. But now they would literally almost have to talk to all the networks to see it. So I'm not trying to be a dark cloud here, but.
No, but at least I know what to expect.
Yeah,
and,
I mean,
you know, I can tell them, hey, it's unlikely, but I'll go, you know, do that. So.
Yeah, I'd say that it's more than unlikely. I'm not trying to be a dark cloud here, but if there were, I mean, even like if I was somewhere just myself out on the, like in some event,
mm-hmm.
right, that might be one thing, because then your people could call CBS and say, hey, could you just knock something out for us, and then we help you, and then maybe you help us. But once you get into this pool thing,
mm-hmm.
it's like getting the bill through Congress.
right behind you, but I'll move.
No problem.
Why you doing that?
It's not a problem, no.
I gotta charge my stuff anyways. Hello?
I'm gonna start, hi, I'm good, I'm at the camp right now. Okay. Oh, not at all? Or just on that day? Oh, I can change it. Yeah, no, I can change it. You just said let them know if there's any, if I need to change it before then, so that's fine. So I can go on and push it, you know, meaning you can push it on Friday or, just as long as it's before the date, so I can see if I can push it to Friday. You can just be posted on the weekend, does that sound good?
this, and so this has been a part, and a lot of people have gotten it. However, became pretty clear to us as we started to see more and more people get admitted to the hospital this summer, most of these folks didn't even know about the ability to get a monoclonal antibody. And so when we looked at the hospital census, when we talked to different health systems, you know, they said, well, one, the vast majority of people that were being admitted were not vaccinated, and but then the 90% of the people admitted didn't get the monoclonal prior to being admitted to the hospital. So we saw that there was a need to raise the visibility of this, but also expand access to it, simply because a lot of the hospitals, if they're doing the IV, because they started doing IV before it was approved for subcutaneous, so they'll have only so many people they can have on that. It takes, you know, a couple hours each person with soup to nuts. And so we knew, hey, as more people know about this, we want to make sure that people have options to be able to do it. It had been up to this point, before we set up our sites, you needed a referral from a physician to be able to go. You don't need that now, because we have a standing order from the Surgeon General of Florida saying that you know, you can come in. Obviously, you have to meet the criteria for emergency use, but that criteria is relatively broad. And so you can come in. You don't need to get a prescription to be able to come here and get it. And again, both clinical trial data and real world shows a significant reduction in high-risk people who then don't need to be hospitalized and hospitalization. So that's really what we're trying to do. We understand when you have something that's airborne like a Delta, you know, people are going to be exposed to it, and you see that really everywhere Delta's come through. You know, you've seen that. So hopefully you're protected with preventative on the front end, but certainly if you do get exposed or get infected, what are you able to do here? And this monoclonal treatment is probably, you know, one of the best ways to be able to do it. It's important you do it early, though. If you wait till you're very, very ill and in need of hospital admission or intensive care, these antibodies at that point probably have missed their window to really nuke this. If you do it early, I mean, you just talk to some of the people going through these sites across the state. They will say 24, 48 hours, a lot of their symptoms have been resolved if they go in early. And so that's a really good thing. So some of those folks, I mean, we've done 10, 12,000 treatments just in a few weeks since we've been doing the sites, and we're doing thousands every day. Just think, a lot of those folks, or certainly some of those folks, would have needed to be admitted to a hospital had they not had access to that treatment. And so it's good for people's health, which is the most important thing, but it also makes sure that, you know, you're not having emissions explode. In the last few weeks since we've been doing the sites, and we're doing thousands every day. Just think, a lot of those folks, or certainly some of those folks, would have needed to be admitted to a hospital had they not had access to that treatment. And so it's good for people's health, which is the most important thing, but it also makes sure that, you know, you're not having emissions continue to explode, and that takes a lot of stress off the hospital. This is a treatment that's free to the patient. The Regeneron was purchased by the federal government, so everything, the whole stock was bought. And whatever Florida draws down, whatever is administered, is not charged to the patient. So people talk about thousands of dollars. Just understand that's misinformation. You're not going to be charged thousands of dollars. How much it costs the taxpayer, I mean, you could look that up, but that, whatever it was, it's done. So we have it, and we might as well use it, and that's the philosophy. There's another, the Eli Lilly monoclonal is not done as well against Delta. There is one with GlaxoSmithKline. That is not something the feds have purchased or anything, so that it's available in much more limited numbers from what we can tell in Florida, but it would be just like any other drug on the market to be able to do. But this Regeneron is something that you're going to be able to have. So we encourage people, you know, if you are infected, particularly if you are in a high-risk group, this is something that's got a proven track record. Now, the folks who generally qualify under the emergency use authorization, you know, are folks who are older, people that may have immune system deficiencies, people who are overweight. I think it's a BMI of 25. People who are diabetic, people who have kidney problems, chronic heart or lung conditions. So when you think of that, really, if you're probably 50 or above, you're probably going to qualify on this. And of course, if you look, the hospitalizations overwhelmingly skew 50 and above. And of course, the mortality skews, you know, much older with this virus than in other ones like H1N1. So if you are in those risk groups, this can really make a difference, and we want to make sure that you have the ability to access that. So if you want to get more information on where you can find treatments near you, you can go to floridahealthcovid19.gov. So they'll be starting tomorrow morning, 21 different sites operating in Florida 7 days a week. There's also, though, other ways to get the monoclonals. As I've said, the health systems have been offering this. And so we've tried to space this out around the state so that most people have the ability to get here in a relatively reasonable car drive. It's not going to be 5 minutes from everyone, but you know, hopefully we have it so that not very many people need to drive 2 or 3 hours. However, if it's not as convenient for you, these are not the only way you can get the monoclonals. Most hospitals are offering them, other doctors are offering. I think actually some of the emergency, Ken was talking about, you know, some of them are starting to offer it as well. So FloridaHealthCOVID19.gov has the sites. There's also other sites that have been offering it all along. And if you want to make an appointment, you can go to patientportalfl.com, where you'll be able to go. This site in Leon should be live on that website soon. All the other sites are live, and you're able to do it. We did have a question on one or two of the sites about people being booked out 4 or 5 days in advance. We've worked with that to try to address that. At the end of the day, this is a time-sensitive treatment. You know, we want to be getting people in, particularly the high-risk people in, immediately. Now, obviously, if you're fully booked, that's one thing. But we've encouraged the folks on the ground to, you know, to make sure that you're getting as many people in as you can, as soon as you can. So these are, this is making a difference. We're, and Ken Shepke will talk about some of it. If you get it early, it's got a great record, and hopefully we'll be able to resolve your symptoms satisfactorily. And again, we're trying as you can. So these are this is making a difference. And Ken Shepke will talk about some of it. If you get it early, it's got a great record, and hopefully we'll be able to resolve your symptoms satisfactorily. And again, we're trying to do reduce the need for hospitalization. Take this from, you know, between having the three vaccines available and then between having a monoclonal, you know, you can really take this and make it something that's more consistent with like a flu level risk. But you got to avail yourselves of it, and you got to make sure that that you're doing it early. So we look forward to being able to serve patients here. We think it'll be obviously Collier, but some of the surrounding counties. This is one to kind of get some of those more rural areas as well. And we obviously welcome from wherever you come from. Come on in and help yourself if you need the help. All right, I'm going to bring up Ken Shepke to say a few things about what we're doing as well.
Thank you, Governor. Unfortunately, it does look like COVID-19 is going to be with us for the foreseeable future. So we really do need two strategies. Obviously, the prevention arm, the vaccines are our best prevention strategy. And then we need our treatment arm. And now, thanks to the governor's rollout of this, we now have wide availability to this treatment. So for the vaccines, I know a number of folks wanted to wait and see some extra safety data, especially some of the pregnant women. That's quite understandable. And I'm hoping that folks will now be a little reassured that we've got full FDA approval now on the Pfizer vaccine. And now, thanks to some recent safety data on pregnant women, the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology and the Society for Maternal and Fetal Medicine have both come out strongly in favor of advising pregnant women to go ahead and get that vaccine. So if you haven't looked at that recently and you haven't been vaccinated yet, I encourage you to go ahead and take a look at that and see if that might encourage you to get the vaccine. But the vaccine takes up to 6 weeks to develop that protection. And that's not going to help you if you get infected today. That's really where the treatment arm comes in, and that's where these monoclonal antibodies are so important, because they can give you effective treatment against the virus immediately. These antibodies will immediately attack the virus, get it out of your system, improve your outcome, and as the governor said, early is better than later. Like everything else in medicine, early treatment is better than later. It's more effective than. We've heard dozens of stories all around the state of people having great outcomes. And you know, one story that really sat with me was a woman who went to our Jacksonville site And her picture was all over the news. She was so sick, she just couldn't stand up. She laid on the ground, and someone snapped a picture of that. And I had the privilege of getting to speak with her. And she really tells us that she thinks Regeneron saved her life. Her mother had seen one of the governor's press conferences and learned about the monoclonal antibodies. That's how she knew to come and get it. And she got there really sick, and now she tells me she thinks she would have been one of the people in the ICU on the ventilator and perhaps even died. And she very well may be right. So for someone like that, I would encourage you, if you're high risk, don't wait until you're really bad. Go ahead and get early. As the governor mentioned, we vastly increased the access across the state, not just with our sites, but emergency departments are doing it, fire rescue EMS agencies are doing it, urgent care centers are doing it. So please avail yourself of that. Thank you, Governor.
Okay. So tomorrow, 0900, doors will be open. Obviously, they'll be accepting appointments, and they will be doing walk-ups. And then also Tallahassee will have a site open as well. So that'll be 21 sites. Up to 300 plus treatments on every single one of those. That's thousands of people a day, which it is making a difference. But obviously, will be continue to make a difference going forward. So I'd urge everybody who fits this criteria, particularly if COVID is something that you have a specific risk for. If you do find yourself testing positive, you come in here. Also, for nursing homes. We've had more nursing homes cases. And if you have that, this is something where you can have a strike team go in and apply treatment to folks there. And, our nursing home residents are almost all vaccinated, but you still have breakthrough cases. And these are some of the folks that are the most vulnerable. And, the vaccine may help them, but it may not be providing them 100% protection. And so if they are infected, this would be an option that they could avail themselves as well. So we'd encourage you to do it. Okay, take some time. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Governor. Brendan Leslie, Florida. I've got two questions for you. The first one, your opposition, both Democrats and some of the media have politicized this treatment, and it's kind of sent a fake narrative out to the people out there that need this treatment. How wrong are they about that, and what is the impact of that on our community?
So it's sad that with COVID, from really the very beginning, it's been politicized, particularly by a lot of national corporate media outlets, and it's got to stop. So this monoclonal, this is not anything that I dreamt up. This is something that got an emergency use authorization. It was given, when in the experimental phase, it was given to the President of the United States when he had COVID. It's been used. The trial data is good. People have had great experiences with it, and we saw that this was being underutilized. We saw that there were patients, most of these patients going in, most of them were not vaccinated. But at the same time, it's like, okay, if you're infected, what do you do? And so if they had better knowledge of this, a lot of them would have availed themselves of this. And so there was a thought out there by some that, this is going to cost you a lot of money, or this is just for some, they were talking about, trying to help Regeneron, the profit. They've already sold all this. There's no anything that's happening. So fake narratives, I think, are very harmful. It can potentially convince some people that this is not a viable option. Again, no one's forced to do this. It's your choice. You've got to make the best decisions for you. But if you do find yourself, with COVID, what are the options to be able to do? And the fact is, this was underutilized. Even Fauci said it was underutilized. He acknowledged that. And so that's what the name of the game is, helping people. It does have a track record of doing it. As Dr. Shepke said, we have a woman who was in really bad shape in Jacksonville. She got it within 48 hours. She was feeling better and said she wouldn't have made it if it wasn't for that. So I would hate to see politicization of a treatment end up dissuading somebody from seeking avail themselves of something that could help them. It could help keep them out of the hospital. It could even help save their life. So don't be that guy that lets your partisan agenda overcome providing good, accurate information and providing access to treatments for people who may need it. And hopefully we're beyond some of those games, but I can tell you, this has made a difference for people. It has made a difference the whole time, but now there's a much broader segment of society that understands this is available. I would talk to people who are very, very well-versed in a lot of stuff with COVID. They had no idea what the monoclonals were. And then when I started, we talked to the hospital, say, hey, the people that are being admitted, how many of them got this treatment? They're like 90%+ never got it. And so we start thinking to ourselves, okay, this can really make a difference. And so please, it's a strong track record. It's been endorsed by the two most recent presidential administrations. Doctors all across Florida and the country have used it and used it very effectively. So the question on these vaccine passports is, okay, you know, our view from the beginning on vaccine, we want to make it available to all, but we want to mandate it for none, because I don't know your circumstances. You have to make decisions. For example, we were the first state to go into nursing homes with vaccines, and we had strike teams prior to CVS and Walgreens being ready to do it. And the reason why we did that was these are the most vulnerable folks to COVID, are these nursing home residents. They're elderly. They have a lot of comorbidities generally. And so we wanted to get them that vaccine to be able to obviously protect them, but then liberate them to have a more normal existence, so they're not always concerned about COVID. So we went in, did it. Many of these seniors were so happy. People were crying. But you know what? There were some that just didn't want to take it. That was their decision, and, you know, my view is let's make it available, let's provide it, but ultimately it's the individual's decision. And so the flip side of that is, you know, you shouldn't be penalized and not be able to participate in society because you've made a good choice. People have recovered from COVID and do have immunity, and that's not recognized when you start talking about doing some of these mandates. It's very unscientific. I mean, the science would say that if you've recovered from COVID, you know, you've got immunity, and it's proven to be pretty doggone durable. There was a study just out of Israel that was really, really strong in terms of this. And so you can understand if somebody has recovered, why they may make. There's other people. One of the ladies that we helped with this, she had a medical condition, so she wasn't really a good candidate for some of the mRNA vaccines. Why should we second guess that and impose a mandate on her or not let her go to a restaurant or some of these other things? And then I think also just the theory behind some of the vaccine passports was that the vaccines would provide sterilizing immunity, kind of like an MMR vaccine. Well, we're obviously seeing that's not true. I mean, the protection is really against severe illness. You do have people that are getting infected who are vaccinated. That is not rare. That has actually been pretty common, and I think you're going to continue to see it become more and more common. So the idea that, because they said, there were some said if 50% of adults were vaccinated, you know, you wouldn't see any waves. Well, you know, in Florida, if you combine the 18 and over with the people that have recovered from COVID, you're well over 70%. You're almost 90% of seniors. You're over 82-83% of people 50 and up just on vaccination. Then you add the people that are there. So clearly, it's not producing that type of herd immunity that we had hoped for, because the hope was if enough people got vaccinated, then it would not, it would kind of fade into the background. Israel is one of the most vaccinated places on earth, and they're having a big surge this summer as well. Some of our most back, I was just in the villages in Sumter County, very high vaccination rate, very elderly population, you know, and they've had a wave. So that's just what the science is telling us, what the data is telling us. So forcing people to show papers or do that, that's something that is not allowed in Florida. We didn't think it made sense, but clearly what's happened shows you're not recognizing natural immunity. That's anti-science. And then if you're trying to act like this is providing sterilizing immunity, that's just not what the data tells us. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. It's becoming harder for people in Florida to get a COVID test. Are you considering bringing back mass testing sites like the one we had at Tennessee?
So we, you know, a lot of the, in fact, I think the county was really involved in that one. And so, you know, the county governments have gotten a lot of CARES Act money. I know they've invested in different types of testing. You know, we've sent tests to people who've asked for them in terms of some of these rapid tests. But there are a lot of ability to get these things at pharmacies and at drugstores. Also, the health departments still do it. So we think that there's a big infrastructure. We think our resources and manpower doing what we're doing now with these sites, we're filling a void that needed to be filled. And there's no, the hospitals and stuff, they're doing it, but they're not doing enough that I think really is going to meet the demand. So we think the thing that has the most impact to keep people out of the hospital, save lives, is to really make sure this early treatment is something that people have access to.
Perfect, thank you very much. So this is kind of just a quick comms check to make sure SINCOM has good communication with Pentagon.
It's not easy to run them. It's a lot of manpower that goes into it. And we've been able to set these up very quickly. And it's
normal. I have both lines open right now. But it will be live mixed when the general is here, if the general is here.
But I think we see even with massive numbers of people vaccinated,
just making sure that we're stable. We do have press in the room, so,
you still see it spreading, obviously, in the southern part of the U.S. You know, we've just had, a big wave, but you're starting to see it increase in other parts of our country and around the world.
The general will be speaking from a different room.
You just have to understand.
That is correct.
Okay, that's fine. Same setup.
And there's ways to protect yourself.
Technically?
Yes, ma'am.
Great. We'll send you an you should be getting an updated link here soon for the afternoon briefing. Just have the general join the room if and when this kicks off. And we'll be doing comms checks early on as well, just to confirm that you can hear everyone in the room.
Okay, this meeting ID that I have isn't going to be the same for the 1500?
Negative. We'll be sending you, I'll send the updated Zoom conference to your email and everybody's email. Your name is?
Chapman, first name's Kelsey with a C.
Perfect. Great, thank you. I'll make sure that it gets to you, and it should be fine. It'll be the same setup as we as when you just entered this conference.
Thank you, ma'am. All right, that sounds good.
Great, thank you very much. I appreciate your time, and look forward to speaking with the general later.
Absolutely. You guys have a good day.
Thank you.
It's 9:00 p.m.
I'm sorry?
Yeah.
Is there an update on time?
We don't have an update on
time
yet.
3 p.m.
This one is supposed to be.
Oh.
I don't know. This is my expectation. So
I think they will merge it.
Probably. That's what I'm thinking of too. I'm sorry, I don't have my mask on. My expectation is that they will merge, or they're going to change it, but we want to make sure that each side can hear each other. All right?
Thank you.
And so there will be a video coming over online?
For what?
For the presser.
If we have the general here for the presser, he'll be coming over through the screen like you have seen for yesterday's UCOM and TRANSCOM the other day. I'm sorry?
General Tyler?
Yes. Mackenzie.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, CENTCOM. Okay.
Hey, it's Harper.
Great.
Hey.
An option, and the availability is pretty good throughout. I mean, we have a very big state. We have a lot of different population centers. I mean, there's some states where you have one or two population centers and you can kind of handle everything. Here, it's a little bit different. So we've had to go and try to get it into as many areas as we can that'll be as convenient to people as we can. This supplements the existing infrastructure, but this is really, really adding a lot to what had been available. And I'd say the majority of people that come through these sites did not know about the monoclonal antibodies, from the beginning. That's just the reality. I think that there was a hesitancy on some of the higher ups, particularly in the federal government, to talk a lot about them. And I think that was probably a mistake. And so now we want everyone to know what's out there. And I think the results have been very encouraging. Well, we have it absolutely. I mean, this is open for everybody. We want to get in all the different communities. Obviously, you start talking about a place like Immokalee. Yes, hospital systems are offering it, but there may not be as much infrastructure here as there would be in other parts of the state. I mean, there's some hospital systems that crank out a lot of these treatments, and that's great, but that's not true for every corner of the state. And so I think being here will be really a force multiplier. It also gets into more of our rural areas, even outside of Collier County. It's
90
days. Yeah. So if you're not vaccinated and you get the treatment, get it. We think it'll help you. But because they're the antibodies and everything, the recommendation is if you then do one of the vaccines, you wait 90 days. Now at the same time, it's important to point out this is for people who are have breakthrough cases and are vaccinated or unvaccinated. It's not, it can be beneficial for both. And the reason why that's something important to just point out is because we have the overwhelming majority of our most vulnerable population to COVID have been vaccinated. And they were, many of them were vaccinated many, many months ago. Whether that the protection wanes on some of this, obviously, if they're going to push booster shots, the implication is that there's been a waning, at least in the protection against infection. Data comes in on that and from Israel, other places. But bottom line is, you know, if you're somebody in this vulnerable category, if you're vaccinated, you still may get infected. We're seeing that. They call them breakthrough cases, but honestly, that kind of implies that they're rare. And they're really not that rare. I mean, I think almost everyone knows in Florida people that are vaccinated who have tested positive. Now, most of them end up with very mild symptoms, which is good. And I think that that's because you are getting some, you know, some assistance from the vaccine. However, the people who are more elderly, the people that have health problems, that could help them a lot, but they still may need an antibody treatment to make sure that they don't end up hospitalized. And we did have, you know, most of the vaccinated, a lot of the vaccinated seniors that would be hospitalized handled it much better than they did last summer when they would go in. And so you do see that, but you may even be able to keep it short of that. So if you are not vaccinated, get this treatment, wait your 90 days. If you are vaccinated but you're vulnerable and you do test positive, you know, this is something that could, you know, could potentially be good for you. And then, of course, nursing homes, places where there's a lot of people vulnerable, if there is somebody that tests positive, we can have a strike team go in and help the other folks who may have just been exposed, may not have even tested positive, and this will actually help in a prospective way as well there. So there's a lot to recommend in terms of this. And then a just final thing, with because Dr. Shepke mentioned it, you know, if you're in an area with high prevalence, if you got and you're not vaccinated, you got vaccinated today, great, but the protection does take some time to kick in. And so if you're in that window where you get infected, this is obviously something, the monoclonals, that you should still have an interest in. So we think that this is going to be great. I mean, if you look throughout on kind of the western side of Florida, you know, we're here, we're in Bonita Springs, we're in Englewood, we're in Bradenton, Pinellas, Hillsboro, Pasco, and then obviously into the Panhandle, there's a lot. So there's a lot of options for people, and we're doing thousands and thousands of these a day. And I think if you do 1,000 people with treatment, if they're high risk, 70% reduction in hospitalizations, that's serious, a number of people. Unfortunately, we've seen the admissions, you know, the admissions aren't as high today as they were a couple weeks ago. And obviously they need to go a lot lower, but we think this is an important part of getting that done. Okay, thanks everybody. We appreciate it. Okay, oh, good, good. So do you guys run in individual districts or countywide?
Individual districts.
Okay.
And a little bit's got my bat phone, the one I answer. If you ever need real information from here.
Good afternoon. We come for an occasion that makes us very proud. As the state begins a healing process dealing with COVID and other issues, there's no better place for our new governor to come to make this announcement than a community that has had to heal and struggle at the same time historically. This is a community that knows how to handle situations and keep functioning. And that is why it is very appropriate that the governor chose to make this announcement today. Now, we also want to make a note to you that we're not welcoming her to Harlem. She has been to Harlem more times than she can remember. And she has done it when she was not governor and not lieutenant governor. She's coming to deal with friends and people that have worked with her. So in many ways, it is her continuing in the bonding and the relationships that she's established down through the years. The day that it was announced that she was going to be governor, she called me and said, Reverend, the first thing I did was drop to my knees and ask God for guidance and ask God for strength. That's the kind of governor we need, someone that looks beyond themselves. She has chosen and will be announcing a son of Harlem that grew up in our community, that has been with National Action Network and NAACP all of his life. So all of you that don't know why Hazel and I are up here, because we've been with Brian from day one. So don't blame the governor, blame Brian's background. So it is my honor and privilege to welcome and bring to the podium, not as we would call her, Kathy, before, now the governor of the state of New York, Governor Kathy Hochul.
Good afternoon. Are we having fun yet, my friends? It is so great to be back in Harlem. There's such a vibe here, such an energy, that even during the depths of COVID, you just couldn't beat us down. And I feel it more powerful today than I ever have before in my life. I want to thank Reverend Al for being here. Reverend Al has so much on his plate. He's heading off to Washington, D.C. to do something that is critically important. He's fighting for our democracy. That's what it comes down to, fighting for our democracy. And I thank him at being the forefront of that battle for voting rights. And I can pledge that the state of New York will be there right at your side, Reverend Al. You tell us what you need and we'll be there. I also want to recognize someone who's become a very dear friend over the last decade for me, Hazel Dukes, the mother of Harlem, the mother of New York, and the mother of New York State, because she has a heart of gold and she is a fighter. That's the combination of women I draw strength from. Heart of gold, but don't mess with her, right? Am I right about that, my friends? So I'm going to continue to rely on her great advice and friendship. Also, right in this very neighborhood, will be the brand new glimmering headquarters of the National Urban League. And I am very excited to be here for groundbreakings and ribbon cuttings. And it'll be the first museum dedicated to civil rights here in the city. You know, 2 days ago, I took office as your governor. A very high honor for me. And it's still humbling to this very moment. And I spoke to you about some of my priorities. The urgent need to defeat COVID, and right now, the Delta variant. And how we need to get more people vaccinated. And our numbers are good, my friends, but they're not great. And this is the great state of New York. Let's take those vaccination numbers and put them through the roof. Let's do it now. Let's start protecting people. Let's start saving lives. We also have to make sure that we get our kids back to school. My God, these kids have been through so much. Our teachers, the kids, and the poor parents who've had their kids at home all this time, they're the ones who are really stressed. I'm a mom, I know this. So we've got to get these kids back to school, especially those from black and brown communities where the kids sometimes don't have the easiest shot in life. They need to get back to an environment that's nurturing and caring, and we have to protect them, and we have to protect our teachers, our amazing teachers who've been showing up to be there for our children. Have a mask mandate. Get used to it, my friends. I'm going to make sure that that environment for school is safe for our children, teachers, and administrators, and that's why we're going to have that across the state of New York. We also have COVID assistance, money that was hard fought by Joe Biden, our president, and our majority leader in the Senate, Chuck Schumer, a great friend of ours, and Senator Gillibrand, our entire congressional delegation, my former colleagues in Congress. We fought to bring the money to New York, and that money is not out the way it should be. So I'm going to be deploying a SWAT team to get that rental relief out and get it out now. So you can count on that. We're going to work with our city partners. And get used to that word, my friend, our city partners. We're going to get more done working together, and I've already initiated those conversations. But one thing I want renters to know, if you apply and qualify for the rent relief program, no one can evict you for a solid year after that. Please get that out to your friends and colleagues and family members. We're going to protect you for a year, but you have to come in the door and apply for that. Also, we're going to do something that might be hard for some people, but this one's really easy for me. We're going to change the culture in our state capitol so people are proud to be New Yorkers. And anyone who works in the state and walks through the halls and considers themselves one of those hardworking state employees, you're going to have a whole different environment that welcomes you back to work. That's what my commitment is to the people who work hard in buildings like these all over the state of New York. You are on the front line delivering services to the people of New York, and you deserve to have a welcoming, inclusive, safe environment, safe from sexual harassment. Let me rephrase that. You will be free from any kind of a harassment, and the buck stops with me to make sure that that happens. That's the new hallmark of my administration. So we have a bold agenda, and this is all just in the first week, my friends. We have a lot to do. And I look forward to making announcements about the members of my team, and we will assemble the best and the brightest that the state and the country have to offer in terms of assembling people to lead our state forward as my partners. Which brings me to today, and I'm so happy to be here in Harlem to announce, and I think, well, hey, this is a secret. You don't know what I'm going to say, right? Right? I mean, right? You're all here for a big surprise. Okay, do you guys know something already? Man, oh man, there's no secrets. I am so delighted to announce my partner, and the word partner means something to me. Someone will work side by side in the trenches. Someone will be out there championing our policies and our administration's agenda in every corner of the state, with a real focus on New York City, because New York City needs our help. And this individual is someone who's been through the trenches, starting locally, working on his community board, working his way up to elective office, and someone I've become a dear friend of in the Senate. And I'm not just talking about our time in Albany, because as you know, I spend as little time there as possible. He has been a champion of criminal justice reform, affordable housing, and tenant protections, three huge priority of mine as well. And he's built a track record of great accomplishments already. And I'm no stranger to him either. Just a year ago, during the pandemic, we were registering voters outside Sylvia's. Anybody there with us? We're literally going up to people. Are you registered? Are you registered? We did this together. In December, we were at the community kitchen, packing up meals for people that were in pain and suffering. We worked on that together. And just last month, I was at the Samaritan Daytop Village Center, visiting young mothers who are recovering from addiction. Too many of our families have had to face the specter of dealing with someone, and sometimes they've lost someone they care deeply about because of addiction. Many of you know the story of what happened to my own nephew, a young man with great promise who started off taking prescription drugs for workplace injury, developed an addiction, found himself in and out of jail, found himself in and out of recovery centers, and on the streets eventually. We tried so hard. So to those families, I know the pain you're going through, and we're going to make sure that we do everything in our power to stop that. And the person I'm going to announce is equally committed as well. So I'm not going to keep you in suspense 1 second longer, my friends. But there is someone, and any truth of the rumor that I'm picking this person because I love his wife and baby girl, Caroline, it's not true. But she is the cutest little girl in the state of New York. I am here to introduce my partner, Caroline's father, Brian Benjamin, our senator.
That Brooklyn, now I'm down in Tribeca, right next to the Narrow, but I'll be hood forever. I'm the new Sinatra, and since I made it here, I can make it anywhere. Yeah, they love me everywhere. I used to cop in Harlem, all of my Dominicanos right there up on Broadway. Pulled me back to that McDonald's, took it to my stash spot, 560 State Street.
Oh my God, what a day, what a day. 125th Street, Adam Clayton Powell, we are here today. Let me first give a big thank you to our governor, Ms. Kathy Hochul. Give her a round of applause. Someone told me it was a rally today, so I'm in rally mode. You know, Governor Hochul is someone who I have a lot of faith in. And it's not just because we did so many important things together over my 4 years as being a state senator. It's because of the moments we had, the conversations we had, where I was able to see inside her heart. And I knew the kind of person she was before she had power. And you can tell a lot about someone before they have that ultimate power. A kind woman, a person of integrity, a person who believes that constituent services matter and believes that it's bigger than us, it's about the people of the state of New York. That is your governor, Kathy Hochul. You know, on my first week as a state senator, she called me and said, "Senator, I want to come see you." I said, "Well, you know, I'm touring 8th Avenue because we have small businesses, black and women-owned businesses, that we want to make sure can survive." This was way before we even got to a pandemic, which has been terrible for everyone. But she said, "Brian, I'm going to come. I'm going to walk with you." She put on her walking shoes. We hit 8th Avenue, we then hit Lenox Avenue. This is a woman who cares about the entire state, and that is the kind of governor we can be proud of and we can work with to make sure that we get through this pandemic, we can get to a great recovery, and we will do that under the leadership of my friend, my sister, my governor, Kathy Hochul. Next, I want to thank my parents, who are sitting in the front row. My mother, I love you so much, Mom. My dad, it was tough for us growing up. We've been through so much. I won't embarrass us here today, Mom. I won't do it. But just know that I would not be half the man I am today if it wasn't for your love and My father, who is actually my stepfather, but he's really my father, because anyone who can raise a young man, particularly one that was not his, that's a great man. That's a great man. They taught me to show up every day, work hard, It doesn't matter what title you have. Titles are nothing when it comes down to it at the end of the day. What matters is what's in your heart. What do you stand for? What do you believe? What are you willing to fight for? That is what I learned from my parents, and I love you so very much. To my wife and daughter, Kathleen and Caroline. Who have been my rock. You know, it's not easy being a state senator, and it's definitely not easy being a state senator in Harlem. Y'all know because y'all give me all kinds of noise every day. I know you do. But then when I see you. But I'm able to go home and I have a great wife who has a great job of her own, and she just got promoted herself. And a great family. And I just want to thank you for being on this journey with me, for allowing me to do this, quite frankly. I mean, this is a team effort. And I want to thank you, and I love you so much. And of course, I have to thank my entire Harlem family. Elected officials, I see Inez and Reverend Al. The community board number 10, where y'all at? The National Action Network family. You know, some people think you learn things when you go to Brown and Harvard. They don't know anything until you come to Harlem. That's when you learn what's really going on. You know, and lastly, I want to thank Senate Majority Leader Andrea Stewart-Cousins, who could not be here today. She could not be here today, but she sends her love. She says, I always have a home with her. But she really gave me an opportunity to see what selfless leadership really looks like. You know, I saw Senate Majority Leader Andrea Stewart-Cousins when she was Senate Minority Leader Andrea Stewart-Cousins. And she was not treated well when I first got to the Senate. But she said, you know what? I am not going to engage in petty politics. I'm not going to engage in personal attacks. When they go low, I'm going to go high. It's one thing to say it. It's another thing to do it. And I watched her do it. And then I watched her become the Senate Majority Leader, the first black woman to ever be the leader of the New York State Senate. I am so proud of her. And I look forward to working with her as the next lieutenant governor. Let me just say a couple of quick points, because I was told to be brief, but you know, Harlem's a complicated place. Being brief in Harlem is hard. But let me say a couple of quick points. You know, we have so many fights that we have to wage. Gun violence in our community. We've got to make sure that we keep our kids safe. The homelessness is a massive problem. Affordable housing, huge problem. The Delta variant, COVID. We just thought we were getting out of COVID, and here we are. We got to put the mask back on. But you know what? We owe it to each other to keep each other safe. This is not about any of us. It's about all of us. We got to make sure that our renters and landlords and workers who have been hurting because of COVID get the relief that's already here for them to receive. New York State government has to work. And Governor Kathy Hochul, I will do everything I can to help you make sure that we deliver for the state of New York. Look, I've got very big shoes to fill because there's been no lieutenant governor who has traveled this state, all 62 counties, working hard. There's no one more ready to be governor right now than Governor Kathy Hochul. But I'm up for the task. I got Harlem by my side. Do I have Harlem by my side? I don't know. I guess I sort of asked the question. But let me just say, I do. Thank you, Erica. Can I just have a Harlem moment, please? But let me just say, in closing, and this is very important to me, when I left banking to get involved in public service full time. I left and I decided that I wanted to devote my life to public service. A lot of people thought I was crazy. They thought that I had no idea what I was doing. They didn't believe. And now I can stand here and say to every one of you, anyone listening at home, pursue your dreams, follow your passions, believe in yourself even when no one else believes in you, and surround yourself with people who support you, real warriors, real fighters, real people who, when you're in your darkest moment, on your darkest day, they will say to you, we can make it. We have God by our side. We have each other. We have love. We will do this. I never in a million years would have imagined I would be standing here as the lieutenant governor of the state of New York. But God had bigger plans for me, Mama Hazel. God had bigger plans, and he has bigger plans for all of us. But he needs us. We need each other to pursue our dreams, pursue what we are here to do. So many young kids who are walking down 125th Street right now need to know that this world is here for them, and we need to help them take it. Government has to help them take it. Our community needs government to work, and that's what we will do for the state of New York. Thank you very much. I love you, Harlem. I love you, all of New York.
I'll take that as a yes. Thank you for accepting the extraordinary honor, and we'll have a swearing-in ceremony right after Labor Day to make sure that we can have the special election for your soon-to-be vacant seat coincide with the November election to save taxpayer dollars. So we're going to have a great celebration then. I also, before I bring up our final speaker, Hazel Dukes, I do want to acknowledge the many, many people who've joined us here today, people I've become very close to. I believe that our chairman of the State Democratic Committee, Jay Jacobs, is here. Jay, thank you so much. It's a very special day. Delighted that you came with us. I just spoke to our county Democratic chair for New York, Keith Wright, who sends his support, his love. He just couldn't be here, but we'll see him at the swearing in. Also, someone who's been a frequent longtime friend of mine, someone I see all over the state when she's not doing her responsibilities here in Manhattan, is our Manhattan Borough President, Gail Brewer. Gail, thank you for being here. And someone who's introduced me to some of the most fun I've had in Harlem at her parties, Assemblymember Inez Dickens. Are you out there? Where's Inez? There you are. Hello, sister. Assemblymember Al Taylor has joined us as well. These are all part of my breakfast club. We get together a lot, so thank you very much for joining us. And of course, I want to thank the entire Village of Harlem for creating this amazing young man who's going to help us lead the state into better days and great prosperity. Thank you, my friend, for saying yes. And I want to bring up someone who I just love. I just love. I lost my mom 7 years ago, and I feel her loss every single day, but I feel her strength. And somehow I think, Mama, you had something to do with all this. But my mom on earth is Hazel Dukes. She has befriended me. She has stood with me through thick and thin. She's my spiritual advisor. She's my mom advisor. And she calls me all the time, and I pick up the phone and say, what do you need, Hazel? Let me introduce the Queen of Harlem, the Queen of New York, our great Hazel Dukes.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and I, second mother of Brian Benjamin, come rejoicing in it. The first mom is there. This is amazing that he stands here, but he was born in Harlem Hospital. Mother couldn't give birth at Columbia. but came to Harlem Hospital. So this is a Harlem born and bred boy that we bring before New York State today. They might not know Brian, but I know him. So I'm going to tell you, New York State, about Brian Benjamin. A young man I met at a fish fry on 135th Street. They told me that he was somebody looking to do some things and wanted to be somebody. Although he had been to Harvard, and Brown, but he wanted to be a servant, a public servant. So they said, why don't you talk to him? Now, they hadn't started Gail Brewer calling me Mama Dukes at that time. But later, they picked that up. So I said to him, come here, young man, at the fish fry. And I wanted to know, what did he want to do? So he talked about, well, you know, Harlem is this and Harlem is that. I said, you're absolutely right. Hi, Rose. Hi, Rose. Rose was there. Rose. Uh-huh. One that helped make him. Uh-huh. We stood with him, nurtured him. And so New York State, I stand here today unequivocally, unashamed to tell you that our governor has chosen a young African-American male, reared in a home of parents that loved and cared for him, that said to him when Reverend Sharpton got a hold to him, you know, Sharpton sit him down like I do and said, what you gonna do? We don't want people just talking. We want people by action. We want people that are gonna work hard. I tell you that Brian Benjamin, New York State, will work hard. I tell you, New York State, that he is loyal. Governor, he'll be loyal. You don't have to look over your shoulders. When you and Brian sit down and make out your plan, he will carry out the plan. He will work 24/7. I've seen him do this as a state senator. As I said to New York 2 yesterday, when you know someone, you don't have to have a script to read off. You know what you know. It was right here in Harlem that he did the Eric Gardner bill. It was right here in Harlem, sister girl, that he said he was going to see that women. It was right here, Jackie Roe Adams, that he talked about gun violence, right here in this very plaza. So he's not new, New York. Not to New York City, but let me tell you, New York State, you're going to have a man of integrity, a man of compassion, a man of love to work with this governor. We will keep New York moving forward. We will build. We will see that our children, let me tell you about District 5. Before he got the call, I called him and I said, Brian, I'm having a backpack. On September 11th, I need some money. He said, what you need, Ma? I told him and I got it. Our children, they lost his money along with Gail Brewer in the black hole, New York City. But we found the money. Our children in District 5, we want the same thing that they have in District 3 and District 2. We want every resource that is here. And I'm sure that when we sit with the governor and talk about the needs across District, Rochester and Syracuse and Rome, New York, I can call the roll because that's where I am. Niagara Falls. We will see that we have one New York. One New York. Striving together, everybody be inclusive. I know Sister Kathy. Sister Gail, I call them my sisters. We not from the same mother, but we from the same faith. of loving each other. So we're going to do this thing. We're going to do it. Harlem, our son, Brian Benjamin. Our son, Brian Benjamin. On to victory. The Hulk and Benjamin team. On to victory. Let me hear you say it. Say it. Say it. Say it. On to victory. Say it, guys. On to victory. On to victory. On to victory.
Yeah, I'm out that Brooklyn. Now I'm down in Tribeca, right next to the Narrow. But I'll be hood forever. I'm the new Sinatra. And since I made it here, I can make it anywhere. Yeah, they love me everywhere. I used to.